Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats as the program will begin in 1 minute. Again, ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The program will begin in 1 minute. Welcome to the stage, Colonel Mike Warlick, U.S. Marine Corps retired Vice President, AFCEA International.
I've been in HOC for a number of days now. I just got released, so no telling what you might hear from the stage here in a few minutes. Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the session this morning, General Crawford. A unique way to take a look at it. We had about 16 or 18 questions. And we'll make sure he gets those, and there may be another dialogue where we can address those as we go further. We're about to start our next session, but before I do that, I'd like to invite Myron Burdett to the stage here to make a presentation.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Myron Burdett, the Vice President of the Local Chapter of AFCEA. Just want to thank everyone for supporting our golf tournament this year. We raised over $10,000 in support of STEM scholarships. And this year we awarded seven $2,000 scholarships to seniors in the local area, along with $7,000 to teacher grants to support the STEM program. If you have not renewed your membership to the local chapter of AFCEA, please do so. We normally average about 400 members in our local chapter. Thank you very much.
The Augusta Fort Gordon chapter is instrumental in the execution of this event and has been from day one of over 6 years ago. We really appreciate their support. And I can tell you firsthand, I went out and tried to hit that little white ball for a while on Monday, and it was a great crowd. I did not hit the ball that well, but I had a good time. Okay, I'd like to share with you just one thing before we get into, before I do introductions. Yesterday, we hosted a STEM forum for educators and industry. It was at the new Cyber Center, which we were honored to be able to participate this in. I'm not going to go into much detail, but I want to give you some statistics, which ties back to the presentation from General Crawford just a moment ago. We had about 100 teachers from the Georgia area. South Carolina was invited, but they started class on Monday, so they were challenged to be able to come over to that event. But we also had 14 or 15 crossovers from this conference that participated or sat back and listened and asked questions. So it was a very, very good session, and a lot of energy has been generated. Here's some stats for you to think about as you're here this week. The U.S. is sixth in STEM degrees in the world. First is China at 41%. Second is India at 20%. The U.S. is sixth at 13%. So that tells us we got to get on with it here in terms of our educating our youth, which many of them will come into the service at some point in time and be distinguished participants. Math, reading, and science. The U.S. is 36th in math in the world. We are 25th in reading, and in science, we're 28th. Number one across the board is China. Probably not too much of a surprise to you, but you're probably surprised at those numbers by the U.S. if you did not know that beforehand. STEM graduates, and this was sort of a focus of how we can help the teachers. And when I say we, it's all of us, but industry in here in particular can do a great job there. China has 4.7 million graduates. This is 2016 numbers, so things have probably changed. India had 2.6 million graduates. The United States was third with 568,000 graduates. So part of that's population, obviously, with those countries, but this goes to show you that we have some challenges out there, and this one-day session was pretty telling to me, and it's something that we might want to assist with down the road for this in the STEM environment. So with that, a little bit of background, we are really honored to have our next two speakers this afternoon. General Crawford set the stage for a lot of what you're going to hear in just a minute, I think, and that can be reinforced. And you can see they are in jump seats. They don't plan to sit in those seats. They plan to rove and to talk to you and get your feedback. First, I want to introduce General Bassett. David Bassett, he's been the program executive officer for command, control, and communications tactical since January 2018. That's a hot spot, as you know. A lot happens in there, and a lot of outreach takes place from there. He leads the team that develops, acquires, fields, and supports the Army Tactical Network, which provides secure and reliable communications to soldiers around the world, and I would go so far to say the Joint Forces as well. As director of the network cross-functional team, General Gallagher, Pete Gallagher, is responsible for the focused integration of network, command, control, communications, intelligence to enable the mission command across the tactical network. He's been the lead for that initiative here for the last year plus. He spent the majority of his career providing communication support to the communications, the special operations, and especially special operation forces throughout his career. So let's welcome these two professionals to the stage. They're going to give you an update on network modernization, and we look for you to challenge them with your questions.
Well, thanks, Mike. When I heard Crazy Train as your walk-up song, I was wondering if were you a disgruntled baseball player and didn't quite make it to the Washington Nats or what the deal was there. But
I thought that was your idea.
Oh, that was my idea. Okay. Well, I feel like we've been on a crazy train for about, as General Crawford said, since about 21 March of last year. And kind of before I go into this, it's great to see, you know, General Crawford sitting next to General Fogarty, because as mentioned yesterday, when General Fogarty wakes up in the middle of the night, his first thought is General Crawford. And as much as I love General Crawford, I'm just not sure I have those same thoughts, sir, but that's pretty amazing. But General Shea, General Wood, General Vi, all the great teammates that are here, you know, John Morrison as my battle buddy here at the Cyber Center of Excellence, and John's been, you know, rowing the heavy sled with us for these last 18 or 19 months as well. But Team Augusta, I mean, you can just feel the positive energy. You know, Dave and I were kind of reminiscing about, you know, back when we were lieutenants. You know, General Crawford, myself, General Morrison, all about 1986, we were running Barton Field with this crazy little German lieutenant colonel named Colonel Eigel, you know, born to lead. You know, he was out there trying to instill warrior ethos in us young lieutenants on the fields of Fort Gordon. It was like 32 years ago, okay? 32 years I've been a signal officer. 32 years the network I've had has never been the network I needed, and never, and today is no exception, okay? As a young lieutenant in Germany, we had the ATAC system. They had track 145s, you remember those days, SB 3614 switchboards, you know, those were the good old days, and we were chomping at the bit to have a network that was mobile, protected, able to enable mission command on the move to fight a peer adversary, okay? So we fielded MSE just about the time I was leaving Germany, and about the time Dave Bassett was coming to Germany, and we were at the brink of the end of the Cold War, late 80s, okay? So then I get back to Gordon, and I, you know, the institution at the Signal Advanced Course, have the opportunity to go from conventional Army heavy division in Europe, you know, looking across at the Big Bear, to a special ops environment. Spent about 6 years in that environment. Again, a different approach, okay? We were able to, at the point of an exercise or an event or an operation, we were able to take an after-action review and quickly solve a problem. So we learned some kind of a DevOps model back then. If something wasn't working, you find a way to fix it as quickly as you can, okay? And so it was an opportunity there for about 6 years to kind of learn a different model. But even then, the network we had wasn't the network we needed, okay? I had, you know, big SATCOM systems, 90 TSC-93s, 85s, but it wasn't as mobile and lightweight as we needed it to be. So we were experimenting with some capabilities then. I get out as a field grade, and I, you know, finally as a field grade, I'm in a division in Hawaii. I've got mobile subscriber equipment. Okay, finally I get this mobile subscriber equipment. But by then, data, you know, the digitization was happening in a place like Fort Hood. And the packet switch network we had could not keep up with the demands of the data network that we needed. So the network we had, it really wasn't the network we needed. So every division was trying to roll their own, and through high-speed multiplexing capability, we were all kind of venturing into how are we going to improve data flow in this digitized army and be able to support the needs of our warfighters. And I go back to special ops. 9/11 happens. We deploy, okay? We've still been deployed to Afghanistan. 9/11, we deploy to Afghanistan. 10th Mountain Division, fielded with MSE, with high-speed MUX capability, the ability to do a digitized division, cannot even leave Fort Drum and bring their kit to Afghanistan because the kit they have is not the kit they need, okay? So what does industry do? Roll up their sleeves, dive in, figure out how are we going to rapidly get capability to the warfighter to turn on a dime and get them what they need to fight and win in the fight we've been in for the last 16, 17 years. The program executive office, the PMs, and industry delivered. We had the joint network nodes, the underpinnings of what is today our WIN-T network, our IP backbone, Internet Protocol-based backbone. This kind of started with a surge in requirements and a rapid acquisition to get capabilities out to the field and support the fight as quickly as we could. Okay? We've been rolling out this capability to fight and win in this counterinsurgency, counterterrorism fight. As General Crawford said, the threat is changing. The threat has gone to school and everything we've been doing. And so, again, we find ourselves in a situation where the network we have is not the network we need, okay? And I think you all know that. You've seen the chart. It's got the left-hand side of the chart. It shows all the limitations of the current network. And on the right-hand side of the chart, it talks about those things we know we have to have, okay? And a lot of folks, when they talk about this strategy that we've embarked upon, this halt, fix, pivot, we're going to halt, you know, further procurement of things that aren't going to be aligned with our ability to fight and win, fix our ability to fight tonight by adapting and buying readily available solutions, getting them in the hands of our warfighters as quickly as we can, and then the pivot. What's the pivot? How do you define the pivot? What's the pace of the pivot? And what does it all mean? Okay? We're figuring that out as we go. But I will tell you, the institutional change that General Crawford talked about, you know, on a large scale, the Army has not changed like this since about 1973. Okay? Back in 1973, if you kind of look at where we were, you know, the Army, created TRADOC. We made a lot of focus on the Big Five. Well, these modernization priorities that we are all trying to enable, the network underpins every one of those, okay? But institutionally, you know, we just announced this week and got confirmed General Murray's taking command on the 24th of August. He'll get promoted to 4-star and take command of Army Futures Command. This is a great news story for the Army. It's a great news story for industry. It's more importantly, it's a great news story for our nation. As we, the Army, fight as part of a joint team with our partners, we're going to be modernized for the future, okay? The dynamic has changed significantly. Inside all these cross-functional teams, we are working by, with, and through our teammates. You see Dave Bassett and me out on the floor together. You'll see Dave Bassett and me conducting tech exchange meetings together. In many cases, we want to make sure that we are on the same sheet of music. Everything we do, we're wanting to do by, with, and through our program executive office, because as General Crawford talked about the why, the threat is emerging, okay? We're trying to figure out the what. What is out there? What's the art of the possible? What capability is readily available that we can buy today, get it in the hands of our soldiers, and then what do we need to develop, okay? What do we need to develop in our science and technology portfolio? Our great teammates at Research, Development, and Engineering Command and all the labs that are out there, there's some precious dollars going into science and technology. But we don't have all the answers as the Defense Department. We don't have all the answers in the Army. We are counting on you, industry, with your research and development and your intellect and your capability to help us think beyond the here and now. And what is that network that we, the Army, need to dominate by 2028? And that network we need has to be simple, okay? It has to be intuitive. It has to be, you know, when all hell's breaking loose in a very lethal fight, the soldier doesn't have to worry about configuration management, okay? It's got to be protected. It's got to be resilient. It's got to be secure. You know, General Crawford talked about reducing the attack surface. I will tell you, with where we're going in modernization, where we're going with heads-up displays and soldier lethality, where we're going with manned and unmanned teaming of our rotary wing, our fixed-wing aircraft, and our ground vehicles, we are not reducing the attack surface on the edge. We are significantly increasing the attack surface. Cyber resiliency and cybersecurity has got to be baked into everything we do. So when we reach out to industry for solutions to help us enable that, I call it the S3E3 model, but it's very simple. Simple, secure solutions, okay? Simple, secure, protected, resilient, whatever. But it's a solution. It's got to be a solution to the problem, not just your good tool, your big idea, you know, what's going to get you your bonus. It's about a solution to the problem to fix that network we need. But it's also got to be expeditionary. General Crawford talked about flat, fast, mobile, and protected. Okay, this is all aligned, by the way. But that expeditionary piece, you got to get off the dime, whether you're at Fort Bragg, Fort Hood, Fort Carson, you got to be able to get into the fight. It's got to be from the soldier on the edge, he's got to be connected to the enterprise. We can't think of it as just the tactical network and the enterprise network, and we have, you know, these. That's been our problem all along, is we've kind of had these segmentation problems where we focused on requirements that were box-centric, waveform-centric, uniquely kind of, we were kind of putting together this Lego piece, and we really didn't have an integrated network from end to end. A lot of work's going on, has been going on for the last several years, and it started when General Lawrence was the CIO G6, really driving to optimize the enterprise. You know, Mike Krieger as the deputy back then, they were driving hard on joint regional securities tax, rolling out a capacity across every post, camp, and station in the Army, enabling the enterprise to be able to deliver to the tactical edge. A lot of investments were going on, a lot of focus, but we've learned a lot of hard lessons as we've gone through that. All of that being said, you know, the tactical network we had is not the tactical network we need. So we have to make decisions. We have to make recommendations at the senior Army leadership level how to align resources so we can make sure that for the network we need, you know, the why and the what, that Dave Bassett and his team can figure out the how and make it happen as quickly as possible, okay? As I mentioned, Dave and I have been teamed up quite a bit, and you'll see us on the floor. We spend so much time together, we can actually
finish each other's sentences.
Yeah.
And so,
boo. All right. It was that bad? Okay. All right. So the joke we didn't tell. I got to go there.
You're not,
okay.
No, really?
Really? Okay. So yesterday.
No, go ahead.
So you know, those of you that you know, waiting. General Fogarty, right? He's been at Fort Gordon before. He was the Cyber Center of Excellence guy. He's a visionary. He's a warrior leader. He and I served in Afghanistan together. You know, when I assumed the title of Network Cross-Functional Team Director, I got this book from the Undersecretary of the Army about John Boyd. Anybody heard of Boyd? The fighter pilot that changed the nature of warfare, okay? He created the OODA loop, observe, orient, decide, and act. Well, all that went out the window yesterday with the SUDA loop, right? Okay, the General Fogarty, I'm not sure what the difference between sense and observe, but I get it, okay? But we're gonna codify the SUDA loop. And Dave and I were talking last night over a brown beverage that maybe we ought to change it to the GUDA loop, okay?
Oh.
Okay, guess.
You're going to go with that cheesy joke?
Yeah, okay.
Right. Oh, he made me say that. Right, I didn't want to.
Right. Okay, back to you.
There. Back to me. Yeah. Right. So as Pete said, you know, it's been a partnership with the CFT helping the Army drive to what we're going to pivot to in the future. And so as I think my way through it, this is about not about what we're pivoting from. We get a lot of advice about what we ought to be pivoting from. And this is now really about what, as an Army, we're going to pivot to in terms of the technical solutions and the design choices that we want to make for our network. And we want to make those design decisions with as much information as we can. I think sometimes in the past, we assumed that there were some really smart people that were going to sit in a room disconnected from the operational force to make decisions on the requirements side about how our network should be designed. Whether that was going to be from a contractor that we hired that was going to make those choices for us, or whether that was going to be somewhere in the requirements community that they're going to imply in the requirements choices a set of network design choices based on available technology. And so when we talk about pivoting, we talk about process and product. And I think from a process standpoint, the process we're going to use to make those network design decisions is going to be with soldiers involved at every step of the way with experimentation, being aware of all of the available technologies, and then choosing amongst a set of choices for specific network design questions. All of this starts out with those questions, and the more that we've kind of gotten into this, those questions are becoming really obvious. How many satellite points do you need in a brigade? We started out in Wintee, we had about 50 of them, between POPs and SNEs and TCN lights and NOSCs. We had about 50 satellite locations. And then because of budget, we started chipping away at that number, and we had less of them. Some on the move, some at the halt. When we introduced the ITN concept, we put a bunch of them back, and we got just about back to 50 in an ITN-equipped brigade. And so those questions about not just how many satellite links, but which terminals, and how many NetOp services do you want to run forward at the terminal, and how many do you want to do back at a NOC? How much of that complexity are you going to present to soldiers in that signal shelter, or in this case, many cases, not inside of a shelter, but operating that equipment in the field, and how much do you want to handle back in the enterprise? Or how much do you want to handle back at a network operations center? How many of those satellite points of presence should be on the move? Is that important to us? Or can we extend that bandwidth with only at the halt satellite and then other robust capabilities that tie it all together? What's the right set of those things? What waveforms do we think are going to perform best, and in what density of radios? How many one-channel radios do we need that do only data? Today, I'm not buying any more of those. And we're going to rely on two-channel leader radios and two-channel man packs running both SINGARs and a new commercial waveform called TSM that we're already using operationally in Afghanistan that's able to support significantly larger groups and better throughput than we were getting out of SRW. Major shift from what are we going to do inside the government with government-defined waveforms? You know, in 2002, when I was working for John Maddox as part of the FCS network team, we talked about the future network being a combination of WinTee for reach communications and SRW and WNW radios. And in 2002, that technology was not ready. It wasn't ready. The waveforms weren't mature. The hardware wasn't mature enough to support those waveforms, and it was a mandate from OSD that we use those radios, and it wasn't ready. And so many of you are coming to us now saying, look at my technology, it's ready. And I've found over the years that if you're selling hope to an Army leader in this environment, we're going to buy hope because we want it to be true. But we have to make it true, and the way we're going to make it true together is by insisting that we get demonstration and experimentation and showing how those capabilities fit into that set of design choices. I don't buy hope. That's not what I buy. I buy capabilities for our Army. And so there's all this discussion about doing acquisition differently, and we are approaching it differently. We're going to decide faster. We're going to field more aggressively. We're going to ensure full integration. We're going to work together as a team. I am looking forward to all those changes. And your acquisition professionals, those members of your Army, with U.S. Army across their left breast pocket, that are part of your force, that operate inside the PMs and PEOs with a really dedicated staff of civilian employees. I have great civilians in the acquisition corps. Those professionals are the ones who've been trained and understand how to best take capability from good idea to enduring capability for our Army. And enduring capability doesn't stop with a demo. It means you've got manuals, that it's sustainable, that it's provisioned in the supply system, that you can modernize it and sustain it over time. We've got to take it from good idea that may operate only on a small scale and make it good across the whole Army. And so your acquisition corps is going to be a key part of that, regardless of where the Army goes with Army Futures Command. As Pete said, it's by, with, and through. And so I'm going to take my 20 years away from the Signal Corps, largely, doing acquisition and understanding all of those processes, contracting and incentives, requirements and budget, technology. That's what I've spent the last 20 years doing away from the Signal Corps. It's good to be back. But while I was doing all those things, Pete was out fighting the Army network. He was out doing those things. So we're going to leverage the capability that Pete has and his deep understanding of how we fight the network with what I think me and my team bring to the table about how you can go buy the Army network, generate good value, and end up with enduring capability that comes out of experimentation. Right? The Army's done experimentation in the past, and sometimes it stopped at the end of the experiment. And the reason that is often because we paid too much attention to the shiny object and not enough attention doing the hard work of aligning dollars and requirements and resources. Taking those things and turning them into programs, because in the absence of those programmatics, you don't end up with enduring capability. And Congress, by the way, funds programs. And so there's this idea that says, you know, we don't want any more big programs of record. I would tell you, eventually you may want some, but what you want are some agile programs of record that are able to evolve quickly to generate technology quickly. And if they grow because we field them across the Army, they could end up as another billion-dollar program of record. But we don't want to make that big bet until we understand where it fits within the network design with a set of those choices that we can look each other in the eye and agree that we've done the hard work to make the best design choice for the network for our Army. So I'm focused on design choices and programmatics and money and leveraging the experimentation and the experience that Pete Gallagher and the CFT are going to bring to bear to help us make better choices. Over to you, Pete. Please, right. No more cheese jokes.
No more cheese jokes. Yeah, jeez. I got it. Okay, that was pretty lame, right? Okay.
It was.
All right, so, you know, Dave talked about ITN, the Integrated Tactical Network. What is it, and what is it all about? And right now, that's one of the things we're focused on, adapting and buying solutions off the shelf that are being used by our joint and our special ops teammates to thicken the network, to improve our warfighting capability. It's really about improving our joint warfighting capability. So the Integrated Tactical Network, over the past year, we've had several experiments and demonstration exercises. Started with the JRTC rotation last fall with a battalion out of the 82nd Airborne Division. And a lot of innovation Eric Carrillo leading the 82nd, his relationship with the special ops community, they were able to get some kit in the hands of some soldiers and get some feedback. And that started a kind of between that effort with one battalion out of the 82nd and the mandate of fielding the Security Force Assistance Brigades, these new brigades that stood up, with a capability that, you know, not using legacy program radios, but actually getting them kit that the special ops community is using. It was directed by the senior leadership of the Army to get the Security Force Assistance Brigades, the SFABs, okay? This capability. So last year at this time, as General Crawford mentioned, he was coming on as a brand new CIO G6. We were rushing to get capability that we had never fielded before into the hands of brand new brigades that were manning as we, you know, the cycle of manning, training, and equipping was all happening kind of simultaneously to get this capability out there. But the first SFAB actually deployed with capability that, again, some of it was program related, but a lot of it was this new integrated tactical network, which consisted of, you know, as Dave mentioned, advanced networking waveforms, different radios than we were using in the past, and different type of satellite terminals, a changing of security boundaries, where instead of secret, no foreign, as a matter of practice on our data network at the lowest tactical echelon, we were using NSA-approved commercial solutions for classified Suite B encryption and operating at a secure but unclassified level, which allowed us to have a pace plan on edge, which is something our squads did not have in the past. And it wasn't perfect, okay? We were running hard, we were getting it out the door, and we got it as quickly as we could. But over the last year, we've got a Security Force Assistance Brigade fielded with a majority of the kit they needed as quickly as we could get it. We've got a battalion out of the 82nd. We've got some elements in a 2nd Striker Regiment over in Europe, and we've got the 173rd has some of this kit. So since the JRTC rotation and the deployment of the first SFAB, we had an exercise at AP Hill. There was a similar exercise over in Poland. And then we recently conducted Exercise Saber Strike and got a lot of feedback from a major UCOM exercise where the 82nd jumped in, the 2nd Striker did a long convoy movement, and they all integrated with UK partners and with special ops partners in a very robust exercise. Every one of those events, we had an evaluation team kind of capturing capabilities and limitations and figuring out what is in the art of the possible. How do we thicken this network? How do we enable it? How is it helping us fight better? And then what adjustments do we need to make? Okay, the next step, we're taking it through. We're over the next year, our intent is to scale this to a brigade size, to run it through the rigor of a very aggressive cyber and electromagnetic assessment as we go through NIE coming up and network integration evaluation. We've got several systems under test, but we are working on this integrated tactical network to define what it really needs to be in the future, okay? And this is a subset of the network we need for the long term. And going back to what Dave said, these network design decisions that we need to make, this is partially informing it, but we're also looking out for what's in the art of the possible beyond this. This is about the fix. This is fixing our ability to fight tonight because the systems are already out there. Okay, so defining that future requirement is where I think the key is. Go ahead.
One thing I'll add to that is that the ITN that we're experimenting today is not the same ITN I think that we might experiment with when we move to an SBCT and an ABCT.
Right.
Because the more we learn, we're going to say, what are the other capabilities? Hey, what role does an aerial tier have in this network? And then at the end of it, we got to look at across the board and make sure it remains affordable within these portfolios. Because we don't want to field one exquisite network to one single brigade and then not be able to afford it anywhere else. But I think, you know, Pete talked about we're on this precipice of what is kind of an unprecedented capability in the ITN that we're now beginning to both operate with and experiment with to continue to learn. I think there's a lot of other things going on as well that are worth kind of letting you know about. One that is I know near and dear to General Morrison's heart is a new ESB enhanced, which is taking some extra kinds of satellite capability, some terminals that we hadn't used in the past, bringing them into an ESB and seeing how we can operate with that in lieu of the JNN equipment that they have today, sort of as an augmentation to what WinT Increment Zero might have done. And so you've now got another formation that we're using for experimentation at what we typically describe as that upper tactical internet level. So we've got the ITN at the lower TI and in the mid-tier. We've got the ESB enhanced looking at the upper tier. And today, we really are in an exciting time for the network with what the programs are going to deliver over the next 12 months. We've got a Manpack radio under contract today, two vendors, Rockwell Collins and Harris, delivering software-defined radios that are going to allow us to interoperate with the joint force. They're going to host that TSM waveform that was introduced with the ITN. And we've got a platform there that's going to allow us to evolve those systems in the future with advanced waveforms. And I know Pete and the CFT have been talking to all of you about a range of LPI, LPD waveforms, backhaul waveforms. We know we're going to be making some network design choices about what set of waveforms we want to have on those radios to give you the best, most flexible capability out there in a contested environment. So we've got the Manpack radio already in low rate production. We're within a very short period of time of awarding the contract on the two-channel leader radio. Again, software defined, TSM capable, SINGARS capable. It's going to address some of the transect concept issues out there with legacy radios. And we're excited about what is today a state-of-the-art two-channel handheld radio that we're going to be taking forward. A lot of progress in that area as well. So new radios, handheld and Manpack, all starting to roll off the production lines. On the mission command side, at 18-2 this fall, we're bringing new mission command software, both for the command post, as well as bringing two separate versions of software for the mounted computing environment. Two different options, one that is really aligned with where the soldier systems have been evolving based on a TAC product, and one that's looking at an alternative to the JBCP software as well that would give us commonality with the command post. And so rather than what we would have done in the past, which was take one product into test as a PM, we've said, look, we want to look at a range of options to inform a set of Army design choices. And so I think that's a little bit, about a shift in the culture that said, we're not trying to protect the program, we're trying to help the Army pick the best product. And we're going to use 18-2 this fall. That change and the work that the team did to do the engineering on that network design to bring both products into NIE this fall is a big change in the way we've done business from the past. So when we talk about the pivot, there's new mounted mission command, new command post, potentially mission command, replacing CPOF as early as this fall with an opportunity to field it across the Army. New TSI server stacks that have shrunk that down greatly to the point where for a battalion, we think we're going to have you down to a laptop. And so a lot of good things coming through mission command, radios, and now some of the experimentation we're going to do on what will come and how we will evolve the WinT network for the future. We got a lot of WinT capability out there. And when you look at the hardware doesn't look a whole lot different than some of these commercial terminals, some of these other terminals. It's got a dish, it's got a baseband, it's got some routers. The NetOps concepts are different. And so we're going to work together with the CFT to see how we can evolve the hardware we do own to become more of the network we need in the future by improving the NetOps, by adding multiple paths for communication, thickening the network, making it more robust. We've got the Trilo system that's been rolling out into the field today to provide that line of sight thickening with high bandwidth, and we're very close to a milestone C decision on a new Tropo system that's going to give you a multiple of the bandwidth that the previous legacy Tropo system provided. So I think it's exciting times. I think there's a lot of options that we're going to use to help inform those network design choices.
So in terms of network design choices, you know, there's some work going on right now. General Crawford mentioned there's 6 modernization priorities. There's 8 cross-functional teams. This week, there's a horizontal integration workshop that's focused on focused on architecture. It's focused on how are we going to fight, we the Army, to be able to dominate, based on what the Secretary of the Army said, by 2028. So every one of the CFTs and a lot of our key stakeholders are in the Pentagon right now nugging through this, okay? What does that look like, and what's going to need to be the underpinning of this network design, you know? And whether you're in the enterprise or the edge, you know, the tactical space that Dave and I are working in, you know, what General Fogarty and General Crawford deliver in the enterprise has to enable that edge. We got 4 joint capability mission areas that have to run from end to end, okay? You got the warfighting mission area, which is all about fighting and winning, okay? You've got the intelligence mission area, which is, you know, it starts at the intel community, works its way all the way down to that S2 on the battlefield to be able to, you know, intelligence drives ops, okay? So that intelligence connectivity has to work through the enterprise to the edge. You've got the business systems that are managed by the Office of Business Transformation. Those have to work from the enterprise to the edge. And then the enterprise mission area itself, every post, camp, and station in the Army, everything that we talked about, you know, the modernization of the enterprise is critical to the success on the edge. So we can't just put all our eggs in the tactical basket. We know that this has got to be an end-to-end comprehensive effort. And as Dave talked about, the resourcing and the alignment of programmatics, if you don't get that right, it's a pipe dream, okay? So over the last 4 weeks, we've been really laser-focused on alignment of resources. With the help of the chief and the secretary driving what they call the night court discussions, there was a lot of, you know, very focused alignment of how are we going to enable these modernization priorities and what can we slash in order to invest where we need it most. A lot of heavy lifting was done in the team of teams approach to make sure, at least in the network space, we had resources aligned to where we need them, okay? But there's more work to be done in this space. And this gets us ready for what we're calling the 20 to 24 POM, or the Program Objective Memorandum, to ensure that we have a plan that we can communicate to Congress that they can understand that is aligned with our strategy that's going to enable us to achieve what the Secretary and the Chief have directed us to achieve. There's still work to be done, okay? As we try to set the stage for the next budget or the next POM build for next year, there's a lot of work on the enterprise. There's things we've got to rename, realign, and break down the confusion, because there's still, because the network is so ubiquitous, there's so much out there, you know, kind of necking it down into simple to understand terms and aligning resources appropriately has been work in progress. But with the great support of the R Cyber team, the CIOG6 team, the ASALT community, not only Dave, but Cherie Smith and Kirk Volmec and all the teammates there, the PEOs, are, you know, every one of the PEOs have a dependency. And so as we look at how we align those resources, it's required all of us to kind of roll up our sleeves, dive into this, and make sure that we can make a compelling argument to the folks on the Hill. Because the bottom line is those staffers in the Appropriations Committee that take your taxpayer dollars and give them to the Army, if we don't have a compelling argument that tells the story we need to tell, you know, they will mark, and we will have to adjust, and we will, You know, so the vision and the path we're on is kind of limited by the funding that we can communicate that we need. So Dave and I will be spending time on the Hill together and kind of laying out the work that's been done in terms of identifying what do we need in research, development, testing, and engineering? What do we need in procurement dollars? What do we need in our OMA backbone to enable baseline services that our cyber netcom can deliver to the force? And so all that work is ongoing as we speak. Go ahead.
Now, I think we're pretty close to taking some questions from the audience in the last 20 minutes or so here. Hopefully, one of your takeaways here, and it reminds me of an African proverb. It says that if you want to go fast, you go alone. Consensus obviously takes time. But if you want to go far, you go together. And I think we want to end up with a network that will take the Army as far as it needs to go. And we know that working that together, and it's our team of teams is bigger than just General Gallagher and I. This is about a partnership with the requirements community and John Morrison, been a great partner. It's about the mission command folks, now with Doug Christman replacing, I already forgot who he was.
Jim Mingus. Jim will be here tomorrow, by the way.
Yeah.
He's got the best, second best job in the Army, right? 82nd Airborne Division Commander.
It's second best to be in the network CFT lead?
No, I was thinking PEO C3T.
Oh, okay. I don't think either of those are true. But it's been a great team of teams, right, with the mentorship of the G6, with the outreach from Cyber Command and General Fogarty. We know we're going to have to work this together, and we're relying on you and your soldiers to give us feedback on our network design choices, to help us make the right ones, supported by data, facts, analysis, right? We're going to get past the idea of shiny object, ooh, give me that. We're going to take it to the next level of detail that says, what are my options? What are the other options in this space so that when we pick something, we can stick with it long enough to get it, right? We have a habit sometimes of being so easily distracted by the next thing that appears to be ready, and oftentimes when you get it, it's not that great. How many of you have bought more than one fitness watch, right? And you were really hopeful about the next one, weren't you, right? And we do the same thing. We don't keep things very long. We don't stick with what we want, and by the time comes, we've already switched to the next thing, and we don't really develop that capability. So we have to want things long enough to get them. And so I think we'll do that by making well-informed design choices supported by analysis and experimentation. So I think we're going to open it up for some questions.
Thank you, gentlemen. My name's John. I'll be asking the questions from the back of the room. Understand that these questions are coming in on email, and the email address has been posted. And will be posted on the video screen. So for anybody in the audience who wants to ask a question, that's the format for doing it. Question number one is for General Gallagher. With the Army's long-term history of decrementing and delaying the network as the first option in any budget fight, why do you believe the future will be any different, and why will the Army prioritize the network over the recapitalization of combat arms and lethality programs?
Well, I think because the Chief Staff of the Army and the Secretary have prioritized the modernization of the network as one of their top six. So that's why. And I think they clearly understand that having a network that enables long-range precision fires, sensor-to-shooter target acquisition, the ability to put eyes on target and be able to deliver the big gun, 1,000-mile gun, if that's what they're in search of, that does not happen by happenstance. You've got to have a network that enables that. Our future vertical lift, you have to have the ability to do air-to-ground integration, manned, unmanned teaming. It's going to require investments in the network. The senior leaders get it. I think we're going to have to fight the good fight. And as I mentioned, we got to make a compelling argument as we lay it out in operational terms, in readiness terms, in lethality terminology that they can understand and they can sink their teeth into. We've got a lot of technical gobbledygook in some of our forms that we share with senior leaders. We got to, it goes back to the discussion I had about aligning some of these funding lines in easy to understand, tangible language that the chief and secretary will support, but more importantly, that Congress will support so that we can make that compelling argument. So I think the senior leaders of the Army are on board with this, and they understand the criticality of being able to move, shoot, and communicate. Okay?
I think the other thing I'd add to that is okay, look at the evidence.
Right.
The near-term changes that were made didn't take money out of the network to fund other priorities. The network was a net recipient.
Yeah. It didn't start out that way, though. The night court, we had a little, food fight on our hands, and I think it was by design.
The results are all that matter.
We were fixing to. This is Georgia. You can say that, right? We were fixing to lose about $1.5 billion in the network portfolio to fund some of the other things, but we got the green light to pull the team together and do the deep dive I just spoke of to figure out what the hell do we really need to be able to get the network we want. Actually, what do we really need to get the network we really need by 2028? And so as the team came together, we got not only reinstated at least the 1.4, but we added close to $2 billion more into the portfolio over the fight-up, and at least that's the plan. And again, the compelling argument to tell that story has to be made, okay? That goes into those forms that go over to the Hill that align those resources with actual programmatics. Because regardless of what you say about the program offices, and I say a lot about this guy, but regardless of what you say about PMs and PEOs, the programmatics do matter. It's just how do we cycle that, those programmatics faster to deliver capabilities that, again, going back to this study that happened last year, the capabilities being delivered were based on requirements that were written that were not meeting operational need. So pulling this everybody together to ensure that the requirements actually lay it out in operational terms that really identify what we truly need. So when Dave and his band of merry PMs out there go out and procure, they actually get in capabilities that's going to meet the true operational need. And that's where the disconnect has been. It hasn't always been in the programmatics. In many cases, it's been in the way we write the requirement.
So the interesting point that Pete mentioned a little bit there was this idea of expectations on how fast we're going to change. And I would offer to you that to some, there's no way we can ever move fast enough, right? We have an urgent need. We ought to be moving as fast as we possibly can. And to others, they would like us to have perfect knowledge before we make a network design decision. They'd like it exhaustively tested in every possible environment, in every kind of formation. And they want that testing done before we ever, you know, make any major procurement, right? If we do that, we will be too slow. So this is about what's the right data. What's the right information to inform those design choices? And so we're already seeing some nervousness play out in some of the congressional language, asking for a little more testing before we make these kinds of major design choices. I would offer that if we weren't seeing that language, we probably weren't being aggressive enough. And so we're going to continue to push the envelope, but at the same time, do it in a responsible way to make sure that we've got the right amount of information for the choices we're making in the investments that we're making so that we've got enough confidence in our decisions to be able to go a long way with this network. Other questions?
Okay, thank you. The next question is, are there plans to leverage rapid acquisition tools such as other transactional authorities to enable rapid prototyping and accelerate delivery of network capabilities to the warfighter?
Yes. Next question.
We're actually doing that now. We're leveraging OSD's Office of Secretary of Defense Emerging Capabilities Office has.
Is that question really whether we've thought of an OTA?
Yeah. We're using OTAs. We've got about seven initiatives right now with rapid initiative funding that we're looking at some capabilities that will help us thicken the network and improve our warfighting capability. Yeah. And we're looking to do that. We've already they'll go out on contract here probably by about 15 September. And we plan to experiment with these capabilities and see where they fit and how they improve our warfighting capability along those four lines of effort that General Crawford talked about. So we've got about seven different things we're going to be looking at over the next 12 months.
OTAs aren't going to be good for everything, right? They're going to be good for prototyping. They're going to be good for moving quickly.
Right.
I think when we go to do things on a really large scale, you're going to want some of the additional insight that you would get with a more traditional contract vehicle. And the best way to make that process go faster is to start sooner. Right, because you want to make sure that I'm not an expert, but I've heard that occasionally industry protests contracts, and so we have to make sure that as we go through that process, we don't lose those protests. And so, our process has to reflect sort of the standard by which we're graded. There was an idea out there that you couldn't even protest an OTA, and that's already been challenged in court. Thanks, industry. So we are going to do our best to use the right vehicle to move quickly, but recognize it's not good for everything. Yeah, I blame you. Damn right I do.
Next question.
Okay, thank you. There's no mention of cyber defense strategies yet, so what priority and role does cybersecurity play in your plans?
So the SecArmy directed every one of the CFT leads to ensure, and basically You bake cyber resiliency into everything you're doing, okay? So when I stood up, one of the first people I reached out to get an L&O on my team was General Nakasone and Ron Pontius over at Army Cyber Command, because I knew with everything we're doing, if we're not focused on, you know, defense in depth, cybersecurity, and protecting the network, because it goes back to those, you know, that network we need has to be protected, it has to be secure, okay? So our cyber, we've got an L&O on the team. They're driving the SEMA assessment of the capabilities we're experimenting with now. So it's absolutely critical, and not only for my cross-functional team, but all the cross-functional teams. And I've spoken with General Fogarty. As we go forward, there's probably going to be requirements for additional capacity of cyber experts on our team. I'm going to get a cyber warrant officer here by January. That will help, you know, build my bench of talent. And so it's absolutely critical to everything we're doing.
Yeah, during the introductions, there was a discussion about the limited number of STEM degrees that are being awarded and trying to attract our young people to do it. I'd just like you all to know that I did my part. My daughter is a junior in computer science, already has her Security Plus certification, and has been working for the Navy last summer. I just wanted to brag on her. I'm really proud. So we're doing our part, okay? The rest of you need to make your kids go into STEM. I'm doing my part.
My son's a liberal arts major.
I believe that.
He had no desire to be a signal officer.
You were too, though, weren't you, Pete?
No.
Okay.
No, I was a math guy. But all right. Go ahead. Next.
Thank you. Next question. How are you going to communicate the results of the experimentation and demonstrations to industry in order to take advantage of all the industry-based research and development that could be focused on helping to spiral to the network you need?
Yeah, so we, Dave and I, have co-hosted two so far tech exchange meetings. One was focused on unified network transport. It's really all about what's in the art of possible for next generation tactical transport in a contested environment, fighting against that EW threat that's out there. That was the focus of our tech exchange meeting with industry last week. We're laying out for them in what we believe is very honest and open terms on, hey, this is what the hell we need and where we need your help. This network of the future, we're not sure exactly what it looks like, but we're going to partner with you to help us create that network design that's going to enable it. The next step was, you know, there's a lot of talk about cloud, okay, cloud computing, how does cloud and the initiatives that the DoD is making and where the Army's going in the enterprise, how is that going to enable distributed mission command in the future? And so we had a recent tech exchange meeting, many of you were there at Raleigh a couple weeks ago, and the focus was on distributed mission command, not only just the mission command apps as we know it today, but what's in the art of the possible going forward to leverage things like cloud computing, edge computing. How do we leverage artificial intelligence, machine learning to simplify the network, simplify decision making? I mean, General Crawford and I have been in the room where General Milley, when he pulls out his iPhone and asks Siri to tell him how many tanks are in the Army. Leaders want that kind of capability on the edge to simplify decision making, okay? And so how do we get there from here? It's engagements with industry with focused outcomes. And so the call is white papers at the end of it, and then demonstrations that follow. We're going to do a Shark Tank-like approach. And if something's ready, we want to align it with ForceCom and a unit and get it out there in soldiers' hands to get some feedback. Will it fit? How does it fit? What adjustments can we make? And get some DevOps construct going, you know, to figure out how this works.
I think the other thing that we've been trying to do better, and I took it to heart when I took this job, is we have to help industry what it means to fit into our design.
Right.
So in the case of Mission Command, at the Cloud Summit a couple of weeks ago in Raleigh, we went out of our way to say this is the Mission Command software development environment that we're pursuing. And what that means is as we make some of these decisions, you may very well have products that no longer fit. Right, that there's already something in the architecture that performs that, or you've complied with a set of standards that are different than the ones we've adopted. That's going to happen. And so what we need you to do is make it fit. Right? You can either make it fit by coming back to us and saying, hey, you've got a modular open architecture. We want to replace this component in that open architecture with something different. You can build on top of our open architecture and add components. You can make those components available to other software applications by opening up your APIs. But if you come to me and you say, the only way you're going to get my product is if you buy off on my entire stack, right, then it's going to get hard. If I got to use your database and your data model and your display system and, you know, top to bottom, I got to buy the whole thing, I don't want to buy it, okay? Because I need something that's going to fit and that's going to allow me to get the best of breed within that open architecture that we're now defining and publicizing. So we, as Pete just said, We want it to fit. We want it to fit into the design. We want it to fit into the budget and into the programmatics. And we're going to do everything we can to help you understand where it fits. But then you got to do your part and make it fit, as opposed to sort of arguing that we ought to throw out everything we've done and start over. That doesn't work very well, because the cost of change then is significantly greater, right? So if you can think about how you can position your products, and I think we've shown an openness to maybe trying to have a broader aperture about our requirements. Now, sometimes we used to set requirements in a way that said, okay, we're going to requirements are like a box that some things fit in and other things don't. And we used to try to sometimes write the requirements so carefully that only one thing fit in the box. And for many of you, that might have been your business strategy, right? We're going to go influence the requirement writers, and we're going to help them write a requirement that only fits our product, right? Anybody ever done that? I bet you have. Okay.
And maybe not the requirements document, but operational needs statement or something like that.
Oh, an ONS?
Yeah, an ONS, yeah.
Or maybe going directly to a unit and getting them. Never mind. Yeah. So we know what you're doing. But ideally, what we want to do is we want to be able to look broadly enough to take advantage of those innovative solutions so that we're not looking at only one thing for that point in the network. And so if you think we've been overly constraining in the way we've specified something, we want to know. But it doesn't mean we're going to agree. So let us know if you feel like we've excluded innovative solutions by the way we've either framed a problem or expressed a requirement. We want that feedback.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Can you articulate why special operations specializing in defeating low-tech adversaries in small, separate teams should be the model for building a network at scale to survive against a near-peer threat in a contested, congested environment?
Yeah, I can tell you that I don't think special ops is the model for fielding a network at scale. What I can tell you is the innovation and the rapid and the agile acquisition processes that they employ, and everything special ops do, they do joint by nature. And so that joint interoperability, air-to-ground integration, that's not something they try to figure out later. It's baked into their ethos in everything they do. They work from the X back. What do you got to do on the objective? How do you talk to your buddies up and down, left and right? How do you call for fire? How do you get emergency medevac? How do you get combat search and rescue? How do you get emergency resupply? And everything in between. So they're always thinking that way from the X back. And if you look at kind of Abrams Charter back in the day, okay, I'm not a Ranger. I got two sons that are Rangers. How many Rangers are in the room? Okay. The best practices employed by some of our most lethal forces out there get shared Army-wide. That was the purpose of Abrams Charter. Okay. The Rangers go back to the conventional Army. They share what they learn. The Special Forces and Delta Force our most lethal forces out there, a lot of the kit we wear today started in those units at Fort Benning and Fort Bragg. We do a very good job in the warfighting aspect of it, and we figure out how to scale it. In the network, we keep going, the Army keeps marching along, and we go back to, as Dave said, we want this thing to fit in this box. Our requirement says we're going to have this waveform, we're going to have two channels, two waveforms. By the way, Special Ops has been working multi-band, multi-mission radios for years as a matter of practice, okay? So we're learning as we go. We understand that not everything they do scales. Either it may be cost prohibitive, it may only work in a certain, it may have a break point. And that's why we're learning, we're experimenting, we're demonstrating, we're scaling it up to brigades, we're trying to figure out how it fits, and we'll see. Not everything will fit, not everything will scale, but we want to learn and figure it out.
Yeah, I'd like to be as agile as they are, but it doesn't mean every product that they've adopted works for the regular Army.
Right.
We haven't made that assumption. A lot of demonstrations are designed to understand what the limits are, how the operational concepts would necessarily drive either a different material solution or a different ConOps on how you employ it. There's a lot of things the Special Ops community can do because they're a much smaller force, and they're operating, whether that means they get access to more spectrum or whether they can use satellites in ways the conventional Army can't on scale, we're absolutely considering those things as we look at the implications of adopting that soft kit. By the same token, I don't think we should exclude soft kit simply because it's being used for special operations. That doesn't make any sense either. So we're trying to, I think I had a soldier one time tell me that HUA was the sound of an open mind snapping shut. right? We're trying to make sure we keep an open mind about this. Hua.
Hua.
All right, thanks.
Hua, sir. The very last question for this panel.
This one's for you.
What are your top initiatives in regards to mobility to the warfighter? Our new soldiers were born with iPhones in their hands. Can we equip them to fight with the same technology that they grew up with?
Yes, and we are, I think. And that's well, yes. You know, the edge device is a critical factor, whether that's that Android that the soldiers, you know, using as the net warrior device. Again, same as our special ops teammates are using. And the network that enables that is key. Whether it's a tablet or an MFOX computer in a platform or a virtual knee board that one of our pilots are going to use, they're using the technology and the apps-based solutions today, okay? And so with soldier lethality, they're looking at heads-up displays that allow the soldier, through his night vision apparatus, to be able to connect to his weapon, be able to shoot around corners, and communicate with his buddies. That capability is being, you know, it's being pursued by the soldier lethality cross-functional team. The network has to enable all that. So I would tell you, we're leveraging, you know, as much as we can, those types of solutions that give the soldiers, you know, simple, intuitive capability to execute mission command and execute their wartime function.
It's absolutely, if you look at the ITN that's going out there, that involves a lot of those soldier edge devices and the HUD 3.0 effort that Pete referred to is taking it even a step further. I think it's actually, in many ways, getting ahead of where commercial technology is at right now. Augmented reality, virtual reality, is something that folks are kind of experimenting with, but we've not seen broad commercial adoption. Anybody remember 3D televisions? That was the next big thing until it wasn't, right? So sometimes we're obviously monitoring that and we're leaning forward. I would argue too, though, that the challenge of the tactical network is harder than the cell phone you have in your pocket. Okay. There are bandwidth constraints associated with the tactical network where it has to then go through a backhaul communication that serves as a bottleneck. I was at a conference not too long ago where I noted that one of the people that was on the panel with me, we tested his cell phone, and he had 60 megabits of service in his pocket. And that was enabled by a very large fixed infrastructure that immediately dumps into a fiber optic network. And so there were no bottlenecks between his cell phone and the network. Tactically, that's just not the case. So even if you can get very large bandwidth at the edge, it then at some point does get bottlenecked over a satellite or some sort of reach capability the way we employ it today. There's some really compelling constellations that are on the horizon that may dramatically change that. But today, we've got some bottlenecks to deal with, and so we got to make sure that we talk about aligning. I think the other place we have to align is application functionality that's aligned with the available transport. Yep. So that we're not bringing services to bear that the transport can't support. And we're trying to keep that in mind. And if just looking at HUD 3.0, we really want to make sure that capability is network enabled, but not fully network dependent because of the environment it has to operate in. And we're working hand in hand with the soldier lethality CFT in that process. Time's up.
I think that's it.
That's our final question. Please welcome back Mike Warlick back to the stage to thank General Bassett and Gallagher on behalf of AFC and our audience. Excellent panel.
I just got a few comments. First of all, I want to know more about the Fogel Loop. I think that's got some leverage to it. Second of all, we have to want things long enough to get them. I think that was a very telling statement made by General Bassett. Thirdly, it is not true that these two gentlemen get paid extra for standing on stage and doing this dog and pony show. But lastly, and I think probably most importantly, the operators understand what's going on here. General Mingus coming tomorrow is exactly what we need to reinforce everything you heard from General Crawford and this General Bassett and General Gallagher, because the operators understand this. Sometimes it's too important for the signal guys, too important for the communicator. When the operators get it and understand it, it's going to work. And it's going to take the entire team to make it happen. I've never seen an organization so energized as the Army has been with this network modernization, or the modernization program. I shouldn't just limit it to network. It's been phenomenal, and from an FCA perspective, it's been very interesting to be able to host a few events to support that. Thank you very much for that great presentation, gentlemen. And as you've heard before, we'll make a donation on your behalf to the Fisher House for your contributions today. And thank you for everything that you're doing for the Army and for the United States government overall. I want to reinforce a few things that Bob Wood mentioned earlier today. You're going to move to lunch here in just a few minutes. You were all there yesterday, so I won't go over the details of exactly where that is. But you know that it worked out really great yesterday, and there's multiple lines. Once you get in there, you don't have to stand at the very tail end of that line for, 20 minutes to get your meal. You have some choice for tech talks beginning at noon. And so you understand the tech talks and also the solution abstracts. The solution abstracts are direct responses from issues that were brought up by General Morrison's team. These are what I call ankle biters. They're not RFIs, and they're not formal requirements. But these are potential solutions to these ankle biters, which may become a bigger challenge in a formal program down the road. So they're open for you to attend. We're going to provide a compendium of all those that are authorized by industry who submitted reports for everybody who attended this conference here. It'll be online here within a week or so after the conference is over. We're going through that now. So you have a chance to do that. You also have a chance, there's a tech talk on cloud computing architecture and virtual data security stack. That's a good one. There's another one on endpoint in Lamar A. Also beginning at noon, and this is really important, General Morrison is gonna be in the engagement theater area. With him will be General Hershey and General Eubanks to answer your questions, a very informal session. General Morrison will be up here tomorrow, but this is an opportunity to ask some of the questions that you might not get a chance to ask while you're here. So it's almost a one-on-one. We're going to do it on the exhibit floor because we need to be down on that exhibit floor, not up here. We want to engage with the industry that's down there on that floor. And Estes at 1 o'clock, the second session of the Small Business Workshop begins. It'll be NIST 800-171 and DFARS. At 2:30, the Women in FCEA panel, titled Women in Government, which is gonna be a great panel, by the way, and it'll discuss academia as well as cyber issues, and you'll see some of the professional women as a part of that that panel that'll really, really make it happen. That panel's also worth continuing education credits as well. The final set of solution reviews will be presented in SSA at 2:45, and that's just what I mentioned a moment ago about the solution opportunities. Next in the room will be at 1:15 to 2:30 is our industry SEMA panel. Again, that's going to be a great panel. It's aligned with the theme of the conference, growing cyber electromagnetic activity capabilities to support DOD. It's going to be moderated by General Hernandez, and all of you know him very well. This afternoon, a networking activities kick off at 4 o'clock with Women in FCEA reception, sponsored by Sienna and Walker Associates. There'll also be a poster show at that time presented by college and high school folks, and there'll be a bar on either side, so you'll be trapped to go to both receptions. Thank you for your participation today. Thank you for being here this week. You can see how important this conference is. Have a great afternoon.
As a reminder, General Eubanks will be meeting with all G6s and S6s in the Lamar B and C rooms at 1300 today after the session on the exhibit hall. Thank you.